still actually, they could still actually come in to the chamber over a long period of time. So mind your head.
Years after the first ancestors were buried here, men and women continue to make pilgrimages back to this sacred site to draw on the wisdom and knowledge they believed was buried here.
These cobbles were brought in here during the later Stone Age.
You're saying that they were brought in long after the grave was actually first built. So is this people bringing things from where they were back to their ancestral roots? Maybe they came, in a sense, home to die.
I don't know whether they came home to die, but they certainly came here to worship the same way as people would go to the centres of their religion. Like people going to Mecca, I suppose, today. They trace back to the roots of their religion. The centre of their community, the Rome, the Vatican of their community, was the Boyne Valley.
We know that for our pagan ancestors, the whole landscape was sacred. But with the creation of these vast burial mounds, some parts of the landscape became more sacred than others. The Boyne Valley may have become the religious centre of the region for the Irish tribes, but gradually over time, and right across Europe, burial mounds came to be used for another purpose too. They became a way of marking out tribal territory. Remember, this was still a rural society. There were no real boundaries, no city walls. A mound meant that a community could claim the land around it, because this was the land of their ancestors. Moreover, leaders and chieftains gained power by claiming they were descended from the ancestors buried in the tribal mounds. The importance of burial mounds in pagan society became such that if you didn't have one, you had to create one. Which brings us back to Navan Fort.
Richard, we've just crossed the main ditch into the interior of the monument, and we're rising up into a very large enclosed area, about 12 or 14 acres, and the whole site's dominated by this big grassy mound on the very top, the main earthwork. There's a huge investment of work.
Navan Fort is one of the last great pagan monuments of Western Europe. And if we can unravel the meaning of this place, I think we will better understand our pagan ancestors, what they were thinking and what they believed.
Something that happened. So we've essentially got the large circular enclosure, the hill that it encircles, and then the mound on the very top.
The site looks just like the burial mounds in the Boyne Valley. The mound is huge and imposing. The earth and stones it's made of were brought from afar. But there's one major difference. This mound is not a burial mound. Excavation revealed no burial chamber and no bodies. Instead, the burnt remains of a vast wooden temple with a 13-meter-high central post. So what was going on here?
Well, that's a great archaeological conundrum, because there's nothing elsewhere really like this to compare it with. And, I mean, we know it dates from the Iron Age, from about 90 BC. It required a tremendous effort to have it made. There were something like 280 oak posts in the circular structure. And then this massive tree trunk at the very centre.
And the mystery deepened when the excavations revealed that the whole wooden edifice was never used. All the evidence pointed to the fact that it had been burned almost as soon as it had been built. The post holes of the wooden wall and the charred remains of the central post were all that remained of the building. The post has been carbon dated to 90 BC. But it is through fiction that we can begin to solve the riddle of Navan Fort. This was an heroic society of kings and palaces. Palaces which the myths describe as being large wooden circular structures where the warriors went to train for the next battle. At the center of this society stood a sacred tree, a protective tree, a tree at which the kings of Ulster were crowned. These warriors were born from this sacred tree and took their name from it, the Red Branch.
It is quite remarkable that when we excavate these sites, that we find that their heyday of use and construction was at the very date that the tales say all these other things had been happening in them.
Archaeology and myth come together to illuminate our pagan past. Navan Fort was the centre of a thriving and powerful dynasty of kings. The wooden edifice built here echoes descriptions of the palaces of those kings. But the stories do not explain why this particular palace was built and then immediately burnt. For this, we need to return to what we know of this sacrificial society.
So how do you explain the burning element?
Well, the burning may have been a way indeed of sanctifying the structure, to burn it and thereby in some way or other to transmit it to another realm.
The builders of Navan Fort had created their own sacred mound, an ancestral home for the kings of Ulster. Their very own Westminster Abbey, somewhere that drew on their past and gave gravitas and legitimacy to their future leaders. So what's all this got to do with us? Well, in some ways, Navan marks the beginning of the end of the old pagan ways. As this last pagan monument took shape in the landscape, Julius Caesar had already been born. The classical world was already beginning to shape our culture and turn us from a rural into an urban society. The deal with nature had always meant that the people were part of, belonged to, the land. From now on, the land belonged to the people. Paganism was coming to an end, but not before it had bequeathed us a final, lasting legacy.
Not only did our pagan ancestors transform the old ancestral landscapes, they also transplanted their roots to new lands, as many of us have done today. And nowhere is this clearer than with the Norse settlement of the virgin land of Iceland, paganism's final frontier.
This is Ingólfur Arnarson, the Viking leader who threw two logs into the sea when he approached the coast of the new land and declared that he would settle wherever the logs came ashore. We now know that there was nothing arbitrary about such a declaration. This was the culmination of thousands of years of pagan culture, a culture that had sought not to control nature, but to coexist with it. And this settlement of the virgin land began by putting itself at the mercy of the forces of nature. The remains of this first settlement have recently been unearthed, and, arbitrary or not, generations of Icelanders have continued to settle in the same place. Arnarson's settlement is in the centre of modern Reykjavik, Iceland's trendy capital city. But this was only the beginning of Arnarson's success story. For within a generation, his followers had not only populated the island, they had also established the world's first parliament. Tingvellir, where the continental plates of Europe and America are tearing apart. Here, the first chieftains of Iceland gathered every summer to debate and proclaim the laws of the new land.
In Iceland, the land was divided into four quarters, four regional assemblies. And then that you